first of three glorious plenaries of the DH Forum here at the University of Kansas. The DH Forum is sponsored by three units on campus, KU Libraries, the Hall Center for Humanities, and the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences. And we're really grateful for their support and offering a free conference, which is kind of rare these days. We have Whitney Trettien, who is a doctoral candidate in English at Duke. She has a master's in comparative media studies from MIT. There, she worked as a researcher for the Hyper Studio Lab for the Digital Humanities. She has a forthcoming printed book and web project on Gilles Deleuze's Logique du Sens, The Logic of Sense. She has published a co-edited print and web collection entitled Provoke, Sound Ideas, that was an exclamation point, which gathers exciting new work in sonic scholarship, and two articles, Circuit Bending History, which might sound familiar to you, Sketches Towards a Schematic, and A Deep History of Electronic Textuality, The Case of English Reprints of John Milton's Areopagitica, or Gitica, if you want to be anglicized about it.
Sound. Printing is threatened with death by the various devices for registering sound. He goes on to describe the physical discomfort of reading books. It strains your eyes. It tenses your muscles. There's even a certain learned dexterity required to flip through pages of paper. We can't read while we walk. We certainly can't read with our eyes closed. Basically, reading books sucks. Why then, Uzan asks, why would anyone voluntarily read a paper book when instead she could lay back comfortably and listen to it? Now, over the course of the rest of this short story, again published in 1894, so we're talking about the end of the 19th century, a short story that's entitled The End of Books, Uzan proceeds to lay out his vision of the death of print and the birth of the audiobook. Books will be bound in tubes and played on phonographs. Libraries will become phonographotechs. Authors will deposit not their texts, but their voices at the patent office, and emotive narration will begin to supersede beautiful language. Indeed, Uzan predicts that certain narrators, these hired actors of literature, will become more famous than the authors themselves. Quote, the favorite editions will be the autophonographs of artists most in vogue, he writes. Everyone will want Coquelin's Molière, Irving's Shakespeare, Salvini's Dante, and Sarah Bernhardt's Hugo. Not only will the quality of narration begin to take a role in literary culture, but readers will become newly mobile. People will be able to read a book while strolling through the park on their promenades. Commuter trains will have listening stations so that readers can plug in and relax to their favorite books, forgetting, quote, the weariness of the way while leaving their eyes free to admire the landscapes through which they are passing. Vending machines on the street will hand out tubes of literature for the benefit of studious passerby. And of course, if you don't feel like paying for a whole tube, you could rent a listening of a book. In Uzan's scheme, a small tax would fund a wandering troubadour-type author figure who, carrying a sort of portable organ slung over the shoulder, might play a book for anyone who may desire amusement in a moment of leisure or cheer in an hour of solitude. In short, sonic literature will permeate every aspect of modern life. The public carriages, the waiting rooms, the staterooms of steamers, the halls and chambers of hotels are just some of the places that will contain phonographotechs for the use of travelers. And through it all, Uzan concludes, quote, hearers will not regret the time that they were readers with eyes unwearied, with countenances refreshed. Their air of careless freedom will witness to the benefits of the contemplative life. Stretched upon sofas or cradled in rocking chairs, they will enjoy in silence the marvelous adventures which the flexible tube will conduct to ears dilated with interest. This then is a remarkable vision. Here we have someone in the very early days of phonography, someone in the first generation of humans ever to experience recorded sound, imagining how the medium will transform and remediate print culture. And in doing so, he's imagining a media ecology that is increasingly mobile and participatory, and a medium that makes knowledge increasingly accessible and widespread. Now, of course, he didn't use any of these words, mobile, accessible, or participatory. These are our words, born of an age in which we now have the types of portable listening devices that Uzan, in 1894, could only projectively imagine. That is, we now have things like iPods an object which has become bound up in our collective concept of mobility and sound, so much so that the word iPod metonymically stands in for digital sound culture. This is what it means to be embedded in a particular culture or a particular media ecology. It frames everything you see, even and especially historical images, such that we can't look at Uzan's images, his plan for a mobile phonographic literature, without also imagining the iPod. We're too close to the moment in which we live and too embedded in its assumptions about, for instance, what it means to live in the digital age. Now, the fact that iPods signify mobility and sound for us, and our minds tend to envision the iPod when I say those words, has less to do with the device's actual ubiquity as a mobile sound device, and more to do with the very conscious techno-corporate campaigning that went into manufacturing this image and embedding that image into our culture, even into our self-concept. Thus, when one of higher ed's biggest and, to be fair, definitely most brilliant champions of technology, Kathy Davidson, produces a press photograph, of course she's pictured with the iPod. Not only is she wearing the iPod, but she's posing in almost exactly the same pose as the famous iPod advertisements. Advertisements that crucially swept in a new era of the Apple cool. Now, this is not a critique of Kathy at all. This is totally beyond individuals. We're deep in the immaterial realm of signs, talking about representations that are always already more than just the configuration of material objects that they depict. Whether Kathy's pose is conscious or unconscious, ironic or serious, whether she chose to pose like that, or more likely, the press photographer put her in that pose, how she's posing is inextricably bound up with the extra-physical and even supernatural representations that configure sound and machines in our contemporary ordinary use understanding of technology in higher education. Now, the simple point here is that we can't ever fully remove these ideological frames that construct how we would read a story like Uzan's or see his illustrations. Not only can we not avoid seeing these images haunting his essay, but assuming that everyone here is a hearing individual, we can never be people who haven't heard digital recorded sound. So Marshall McLuhan got a lot of things wrong, but one of the things he seems to have gotten right is this idea of sense ratios. That is, that each new technology, when it's brought into the cultural milieu, creates, quote, new equilibriums among other organs and extensions of the body, such that how we in this room experience sound is fundamentally different from how Uzan experienced sound when he wrote his story in 1894. In this way, the signs or the representations of our techno-corporate digital culture have worked themselves into our material experience of sound, and by extension, our relationship to the audible past. Now, this is a crazy place to be as an historian. On the one hand, we have an image like this drawn over a century ago. This image was published in print as a projection of the future of print. So to be clear, the printed object is disseminating an imagined future in which print has been supplanted by the very thing that it's illustrating. This is the fundamental weirdness of all media history, right? It's this idea that our historical subjects are also the things that are telling us history. In other words, when we're working with a printed article from 1894 about the demise of print, we're not just studying archival content, but we're dealing with the archival mechanisms themselves as historical agents. In other words, agents that are structuring the very history that they're transmitting to us. Lisa Gittleman has put this conundrum very succinctly when she states that media, quote, represent and delimit representing. So there's the problem of media history itself, but complicating matters, there's the problem of us within that history. So we're looking back to them, looking forward to us, and we're doing so from a perspective that makes it fundamentally impossible for us to know what it was like to be in 1894 experiencing sound for the first time. Thus, the image wavers with this kind of historical bistability. One moment, this jaunty man on his promenade seems oddly familiar. The next moment, the image is strange. It's very distant. His late Victorian costume seems to clash with the newness of the technology that he carries. So, as a diligent academic, there's two kinds of things that I could do with this, right? We could do a kind of Latourian, we have never been modern move, and use this particular juxtaposition to expose the bits of dust that cling to all of our shiny new machines. In other words, to show that the things that we take to be new are really not so new after all. Or we could do a kind of steampunk move and make the past shinier than we expect it to be, make it gleam with the newness of our own age, right? So if Latour could hypothetically make iPod seem like old hat, then steampunk makes something like a hot air balloon or a linotype machine seem as technically innovative as the latest in touchscreen technology. But either way, both of these moves share the impulse to reduce the difference between these two periods. By absorbing both images into the same cultural bloodstream as our own, we've defamiliarized ideas or people or artifacts that otherwise seem distant and strange. In this way, Uzan becomes in some sense just like us, even when the irony of such juxtapositions prove just how different from us he actually is, just how different the media ecology that he inhabited is. Now, this is a really frustrating kind of Moebius strip of retrofuturistic wonder, an image like this, of us looking at them, looking at us, looking at them. And although it would seem that the proliferation of inscriptive technologies, things like books and audio that store and transmit history, would have brought us closer to the past simply by bringing us more materials as a historian to look at, in fact, this kind of infinite production of reproductions has, for me, only served to make the difference between us in our moment and them in their moment seem all that much more strange. Thus, a seemingly insurmountable gap is yawning between past and present, even and especially in those moments when we seem closest to understanding it. Now, the very simple point of my talk, in four words, is that materiality disrupts all of this. I want to put aside Uzan and the iPod for a second and share two examples of contemporary phonographic literature. The first is this, the Most Amazing Science pop-up book. This is a cool book for a lot of reasons. It has a working microscope, a working camera, and a working kaleidoscope made out of paper as pop-ups. And it also has a working phonograph made out of paper and a vinyl disc. Now, I'm not going to spin it because it's getting delicate as it ages, but basically you spin this and you hear a scratchy little sound. It's not, you know, it's not radically innovative here. But it's showing you how vinyl sound works. It's not phonographic literature exactly as Uzan imagined it, precisely, but it's not so far off either if we approach it as a material artifact that is constructed to convey information through sound embedded in the material form of a book. The second one is this. A greeting card, a simple greeting card that has a sound chip embedded in it. Here we have mobile sound, sound that one can carry in one's pocket. It can be participatory. I collect these things. So it reacts to me. Okay. I even have one that I didn't bring that when you open it, it has a sound chip that when you press it, it modulates the pitch of the sound. So you can kind of play with the sound a little bit. Now, this is not exactly high literature, right? It's not Irving's Dante or whatever. But if all we're searching for are structurally resonant examples of phonographic books, then both this pop-up book and this sonic greeting card are worth comparing, especially comparing to Uzan's vision. So what's the point? The point is that although we can never fully see outside the ideologies that frame us, materiality or objectness can at least help us see the frame itself. So phrases like digital culture are tossed around so much that we all start to blithely accept that we all know what this means. We have an ordinary use definition, and that definition is correct. Now, if we attend to material objects, it can help mute this kind of flurry of representations of what digital culture is, and jarring our own assumptions. For is this a sonic book, an audio book? Nothing about it screams digital audio to us. And in fact, I'm guessing if we were to do a word association exercise, nobody on digital sound culture, nobody would have put sonic greeting card on that word association exercise. And yet here we have a digital recording device that's embedded in paper, and it's very much a mobile digital device. As an object placed in a particular historical context, then, this greeting card defamiliarizes what has become most familiar to us about our own moment. Materiality, then, is an immensely powerful tool for digital humanities. It can help challenge our own assumptions about the machines that we use, the methods that we use, and it can force us to think about and even do our work in new ways. In fact, a great example of this came up just this week on DH Answers. Zach Whalen described an assignment that he has his students do in which they take apart old media devices, learn about their key components, and then create an Omeka exhibit from it, using NeatLine to trace each component in time and space. Now, his question for DH Answers was this: what Dublin core fields should his students use when entering the items into Omeka? Is the factory that produced a particular chip its creator, its publisher, its source? Here, then, the material form is butting up against the ontologies that were used to order and describe these forms, and is doing so in a way that's exposing the assumptions built into the system of markup. So the assignment itself worked on multiple levels. On the one hand, students got to learn that electronic objects are designed objects. Further, they got to see how those material objects are translated into a digital space like Omeka. But on another level, it pushed Zach as the professor's scholar to look deeper into the ontology of metadata as such, and to do so in a way that sparked an interesting conversation about cataloging old machines. This is increasingly important with labs like the Media Archaeology Lab at University of Colorado, Myth's Vintage Computers Lab, Gentry and the Maker Lab at UVic that he's going to talk about a little bit more on Saturday. So these have become important questions. Increasingly, the material weight of our technological history is pressing upon us and forcing us to reevaluate images, ideologies, and textual systems that are structuring our relationship to it. Now, if you'll indulge me in a little bit of media wonkiness, I think one helpful way of conceptualizing this is through a passage by Wolfgang Ernst, in which he describes material artifacts of the past as, quote, the artifactual hardware upon which historical discourse operates like a form of software. So this passage is worth unpacking a little bit and quoting more at length. So he's saying, quote, antiquarians, by which he means those of us like me who are nostalgic for material objects, especially objects of the past, have tried to bridge this gap by touching and tasting the immediate material objects. For antiquarians, collectors, history is not just text, but the materialist emancipation of the object from an exclusive subjection to textual analysis. So to reiterate then, artifacts are the hardware upon which historical discourse operates like a form of software. Now he concludes, just to finish the passage, if we redeploy the analytical tools developed by so-called new historicism in literary studies, studies from textual analysis and so on, and apply them to material cultural studies, we find not only archival data on history, that is kind of the regime of the archive, but also, as opposed to this textual narrative history, the otherness of the material fragment. So there's a lot of phrases in there, so I'll just unpack that really quickly. What he's saying is that literary forms of textual analysis encourage us to write history in linear narrative form, the form of the text itself, one word stepping after another. Now, if we apply these same types of literary analysis to objects, they resist that kind of narrative interpretation, as we saw they did in Zach's class. They're strangely other from the textual forms of scholarship, in other words, that we usually engage. In a digital milieu that's swimming with these virtualities, these signs, these kind of immaterial images, and I would say they're not actually immaterial, but they present themselves to us as if we should read them as dematerialized. Insofar as we're stuck in this situation, a return to materiality, a very conscious return to materiality, can be a very powerful hermeneutic tool. So I want to push Ernst's metaphors beyond a mere description and toward a method in which we're not just locked at the level of software, i.e., not just locked at the level of discourse, but are actively engaging and rewiring our relationship to historical artifacts. Here I have found inspiration in circuit bending. Now this is probably going to be familiar to a lot of people in the room. It's an increasingly familiar practice of cracking open consumer electronic devices and rewiring them to do something different from what they originally intended to do. So here you're watching a group of Czech hackers basically crack open a Care Bear and make it such that its eyes flash red and it says Satan when you cuddle it. So some scholars have begun adopting methods like these as both a pedagogical and a research practice. And here I'm particularly excited to hear Gentry talk again about the Maker Lab at UVic, but I'll just give one quick example from a recent project that I'm working on at Duke. I co-direct a project called Soundbox, and our goal is really to bring together a multidisciplinary group of sound scholars, artists, and makers who want to use sound in unusual ways. And one of our collaborators right now is a composer. His name's Kenneth Stewart, and he's interested in the history of the electric guitar, especially in the development of various processing effects. So instead of writing an article about this, he's making this kind of zombie machine. You see here an anti-gif of the various different kind of states it's gone through so far, made out of various broken guitars and pedals, even other stringed instruments that have this kind of material resonance with the body of the electric guitar. And he's outfitting it with sensors that allow the pieces to interact in various ways that embody then the history of the effect. So the material thing that he's producing is actually his scholarly contribution to our project. By working with physical objects, he's produced tangible knowledge about the culture of the electric guitar and its sonic effects. And he's done so in a way that breaks that loop of kind of ironic, retro-futuristic nostalgia we find ourselves in with Uzan and the iPod. Because instead of working within the realm of discourse, he's gone back to the hardware, discourse software, i.e., he's gone back to the hardware of history, the objects of history, and rewired them to produce new sounds and new signals to help the rest of us understand it. So I think we can push this idea of circuit bending as a historical practice a little bit further, because unlike Ken, I work with really old books, books that I can't really buy and crack open. And unless the British Library decides to pull a Senate House library and suddenly start selling off its most valuable treasures, and does so in the year that I win the lottery, there's just no way I'm going to be able to purchase these books and do anything other than with them than gaze upon them politely in the nice silence of the reading room. But increasingly, I have these digital images, accessible on the web via some kind of CMS, a content management system. I want to see what happens if we, as scholars and librarians who work with and design these systems and materials, think about our digitization practices as performing a kind of circuit bending of history. For, although to state a point that sounds obvious, but I actually think is not, systems like this, i.e. turning the pages, which has then put in a medieval Arabic manuscript, image of a medieval Arabic manuscript, these constitute a significant transformation of how we interact with the past, with archival content. This is a remediation of an object into a new form that physically and temporally rewires the original book's operational logic, its functionality, how its pages turn have changed, how it relates to its human user changes. More pithily, we might say something like digital archives of this sort are altering the codes of the codex. Moreover, it's remediation performed by an assemblage of software that's designed by humans to enable precisely a particular relationship to the object. And to take this even one step further, this new relationship has, in a very literal way, altered the original object's material existence by exploding it across a multiplicity of forms, different reproductions, each of which exists in different spaces. So that's a really dense set of provocations, I know. And I want to spend the remainder of this talk just exploring what I mean by all of this. And I want to do that by looking at a set of books that I've been studying recently, which I think deserve a lot more attention than they've had. These are the Little Gidding Harmonies, a set of books from the 1630s, so they're almost 400 years old, produced just outside Cambridge in England by a religious community primarily of women. This very unique set of books was made by cutting apart different editions and prints of the four Gospels, then pasting them back together into a cohesive linear narrative of Christ's life. So in other words, these books look printed, and in fact they're designed to look printed, and they fooled even many an aristocratic visitor who came to the community and said, "I'm sure these women are hiding a printing press somewhere in their closets." You can see there how much they look printed. In fact, they're actually composed entirely of bits and pieces of other books, so there's not a single bit of type being printed here. Later Little Gidding Harmonies have exploited the form and function of different typographies, different colored inks, to construct multiple reading pathways through the story. In other words, this page's design allows the reader to read the narrative with an eye towards variance, and even to read it against the grain of the composition's cohesive linearity. So in other words, it's both a compelling story that's told along a kind of linear arc, but it's also presented as a complicated, interwoven, and even at times contradictory material document. They refuse to mute the contradictoriness of this thing. So we have these books. These are exactly the type of books that can't be produced in a print edition. That's exactly why they haven't had any work done on them in 400 years. You know, regimes of print that have structured scholarly work, we all know this, for at least the last two centuries, and this thing just doesn't fit into that. I don't even know what a printed textual edition of this kind of thing would look like. So I've decided that I want to create a digital facsimile edition in order to bring more attention to these books. Now, what would this digital edition do to these books as material objects? Well, the first step, of course, is to get high-quality photographs to work with, and I've done that. We now have one full harmony that's digitized in high-resolution digital images. These photos are frozen moments in the life of the harmony. They're mediated by a camera, which took the photo at some point in 2012, and by the screen, which is now showing us these images. As information, these images are currently stored on my server, on Harvard's server, and posted online for others to access. I'm trying to be painfully obvious here because I want to trace the material networks of what's actually happening with these. Though I haven't seen or touched these servers, they might look something like this, I'm not sure. There is a noisy weight to them. Somewhere, very far away, they're making a noise like this, sucking up electricity, blowing out hot air, spreading sound and heat into their surrounding environment. Now, the more web users access these images, the harder the servers work, thus increasing the amount of energy that they're using. In aggregate, the energy used by these servers has an impact on the environment, but absolutely no impact on the digital artifact itself. Now, this deferral of a physical impact away from the material thing itself is critically different than what happens when a historian sees the original object in the archive. My physical handling of the Little Gidding Harmony at the Houghton Library inevitably left minute traces of me on the book, of my bodies, of the bodies in the room with me, of the air, the humidity of that day, on that brief afternoon when it came out of the vault and got put on my desk in the reading room. Thus, when I view the Little Gidding Harmony in the library, I'm witness to its existence across multiple centuries. In other words, to its physical aging and preservation, as well as its co-presence in the now with me right here in this moment, in which it's continuing to accrete material stuff. Now, no matter how many times I page the online facsimile, though, I won't alter the book's appearance. Instead, my trace is left where I can't see it, in distant places, deferred onto the impact of technology waste, climate change, the depletion of the planet's natural resources, fossil fuels, electricity, metals, minerals used to manufacture the server. The list goes on and on and on if we want to talk about objects that went into producing this. Not only is my physical material impact deferred away from the object itself, but the site of my interaction with the book, the screen, is presenting to me an eternally returning present moment, the moment when the book was photographed. So this representation is not subject to the same moment as me. It's just dragging the same moment across a multiplicity of different moments. So to state that digital facsimiles are presenting this kind of eternally returning frozen now is more than ethereal philosophizing. If I download a page image from the digitized harmony to my local hard drive, as I did here, you can see in January, or even just access it online, the date and time of the download become the date created in the photo's metadata, or the date accessed in my cache, thus giving the appearance of an image updated with every viewing. Thus, while the image as a representation here remains frozen in time, the image as data is temporally on the move, copied from my server today to the local hard disk drive of some website visitor tomorrow, to another set of storage hardware next month, and this kind of constantly fluctuating rematerialization of bits and bytes. And importantly, these fluctuations occur even without my intervention, as my hard disk drive is shuffling the data, cutting and pasting new data over the old, to create this kind of palimpsest of frozen moments in the history of my storage device. So we can even see these magnetic inscriptions with technology like what you're looking at here, magnetic force microscopy, where you can see the kind of inscriptions of magnetic data onto hard disk drives, and BitCurator and some other projects are doing really interesting work with this kind of digital forensics right now. Of course, these systems are not entirely stable, so this storage hardware would require replacing anywhere from every 3 to every 20 years to avoid bit rot and technical obsolescence and all these things, which is yet one more way that the material impact of digitization is being both temporally and spatially deferred. So we have our images. And we have a basic, though not by no means complete, understanding of their material existence across multiple sites, from the servers they're on, to my screen, to my hard drive. Now, the next step in the project is to devise a way of presenting these images and unlocking their data in a way that it becomes manipulable and visualizable and searchable in various ways. And in most cases, almost all cases, this means transcribing and marking up the text. And here, Paul Dyke has already done that with one full harmony. Not a harmony that's been digitized, unfortunately, but he's written very beautifully about the process, and many of my comments here are really indebted to his work. But long story short, marking up a text like the harmony makes it useful for all types of reasons, searchable, manipulable, in ways that the raw image cannot, at least can at this point. So here again, though, the materiality, the physical artifact unmoors our assumptions. For one, the women of Little Gidding are already working with one of the most heavily marked up texts in the Western world. That would be the Bible. This is a document divided not only into books, but chapters and verses replete with marginal annotations, structural marks, and an extensive textual apparatus. Verse divisions in the Bible were relatively new when the women were, of Little Gidding were working with the Bible. They emerged around 1560, and here you're looking at a Geneva Bible from the 1560s, so they're less than a century old at this point. And while lots of very kind of deterministic arguments have been made about what it means to have divided the Bible into chapter and verse, one thing that we can say is that doing so presents a remarkably marked up text in appearance. Now, when the women of Little Gidding were cutting apart these verses, they were doing so with a consistent fidelity to the original verse divisions. They used the cut-up, in other words, not as a way to redefine the verse structure, but to further mark the boundaries or limits of them. So, to give an example, if we zoom into the collection section of chapter 35 here, we see that the first phrase, "while he spake these things unto him," and I'm looking at the top right here, is pasted in Gothic letters, indicating that it's to be read within the main narrative, or what in Little Gidding's kind of idiosyncratic terminology is called the context. So that's the context. The rest of the verse below, from behold on, is pasted in a Roman font, indicating that it's supplemental to the main narrative, usually because it's repetitive in some way. So if one is primarily interested in reading a linear narrative, this supplemental text could just be disregarded, and you could just read the black letter. If one is interested in comparing Bible verses or in parsing the subtle differences between how much weight one gives to one evangelist over another or so on, then this contextual material becomes the primary site for kind of exploring those contradictions. Thus, the women of Little Gidding are using distinctions in type to mark up the already marked territory of the Bible. Okay, so just to be clear there, what they're doing is using the visual expressive materiality of the Bibles that they're cutting up to mark up the Bible into their own interpretation or their own edition. And they are doing so without adding anything to the text itself. Rather, they're just manipulating pre-existing structures, found structures that they've found in other printed books. Now, the hardcore text crunchers in the room will know Dino Bazzetti's famous critique of strongly embedded markup. Basically, he claims that markup languages are fundamentally confused since they're both describing and also participating in the textual expression whose content they describe. So in other words, here you're looking at both the text of the Bible, but you're also looking at the markup, and that you can't, the markup is participating in the text itself. Well, here, with the women of Little Gidding nearly 400 years earlier, they found a really deft workaround for just such a problem. And they basically, their workaround is simply to use materiality and the visual design of the book to mark up the text that they're working with. Now, another way of saying this is to point out that digital editions like this tend to exacerbate the distinction between text and work. That is, they're further entrenching in our scholarly mindset this idea that there are immaterial ideal texts floating on the left, floating above the material instantiation, which is represented by a digital facsimile, which, as we've already seen, is this kind of frozen moment anyways, on the right here. Text, work. Somehow these are then fundamentally different. Yet, in a book like the Harmonies, there just is no text-work distinction. The work is the text. Once again, the materiality of these books as designed objects has given us a new perspective on our own contemporary debates and the assumptions about textuality that are built into those debates. So, on the one hand, we have a desire to take advantage of all the wonderful aspects of digital humanities, right? The ability to bring images of rare, inaccessible books to a wider audience, to make textual information searchable and manipulable in digital environments. On the other hand, we have this book whose extraordinarily sophisticated cut and paste method of production is resisting any effort to transform its text into images or into this kind of crust of data that's separable from the document itself. So how can we mash these together? How can we employ digital media in a meaningful way to produce an edition that is suited to these books? So I don't have an answer for this yet. I'm still searching. But one lesson here that we can learn is to listen to what objects have to tell us, especially what they have to tell us about our own work. Our methods, and here I'm thinking in particular within textual editing, but this applies to all different realms, we have to remain plural enough in our methods and wide enough in scope to respect the original book and artifact as more than just an image. Books are highly three-dimensional designed objects, to state the obvious, with very specific tactile functionalities. The Harmonies in particular taught us this lesson because they're showing an amazing sensitivity to writing itself as a material process, in a way that circuit bends our own assumptions about what it means to be an author or a publisher or a creator. Our work digitizing these types of objects should reflect a deep awareness of this. Now, this might mean that more digitization projects require small boutique editions, at least for books like this. For instance, drawing inspiration from Uzan and sonic greeting cards and circuit bending in general, I could imagine a paper edition that incorporates an author's voice reading his or her own work with cheap sound chips. I could imagine ethnomusicologists using these sound chips to embed sound into their books, embed field recordings into their books. I could even imagine them being used for others to annotate copies of their books with audio. And this would be very interesting as well with the harmonies. Harmonies, they're drawing from the language of sound already, which is a book that was produced in a single physical space in which women were reading aloud to each other as they produced them. So I can kind of imagine the outline of an edition that somehow brings the sociality of sound inherent in the original process of producing these books back into a digital edition. Now, like all remediations, this would be some zombified hybrid edition, this kind of pieced together remix of contemporary voices and contemporary images of old books. But it would be so in an intentional way, in a way that didn't present the artifact just as text or try to situate it within a particular narrative discourse, but would rather encourage its users to engage with it as a historically situated artifact. In other words, as an edition that was designed within a particular moment for a book that was also designed within its own particular moment. So this is a kind of play over, over presentation, awareness of process over edited product approach. I think I'm running out of time, so I'm going to end there. Uzan, basically, to return to Uzan, has ended his book, entitled The End of Books, with a very dire prediction. He writes, "Either the books must go or they must swallow us up." I calculate that, he continues, the whole world over from 80 to 100,000 books appear every year. He's saying this in 1894, remember, at an average of 1,000 copies. This makes more than 100 million books, the majority of which contain only the wildest extravagances or the most chimerical follies, and propagate only prejudice and error. Our social condition forces us to hear many stupid things every day. A few more or less do not amount to a very great suffering in the end, but what happiness not to be obliged to read them and to be able at last to close our eyes upon the annihilation of printed things. Now, Uzan, I think, is being a little bit tongue-in-cheek. Print obviously hasn't left us. We all know that now. Not only has print not left us, but I think that the printed artifact, its material forms and functions, has a bright and promising future in digital humanities work, as more media artists are exploring the space between page and screen, and as more scholars are experimenting with hybrid publishing models. In fact, the promise of so much recent work is precisely this ability to short-circuit the narrative of successive information ages that has somehow become canon. So with that, I'm not going to force you to hear any more of my wildest extravagances, and we'll take questions. Thank you for listening.
It's not a terribly deep question, but I'm curious about how you stumbled upon this book, this Harmonies and this Kidding.
So there's a book by Will Sherman called Used Books, and he has one sentence about these books in it. And I read it a couple years ago and remembered it and wanted to follow up. And when I did, they're way more interesting than turns out than I could have imagined. So there's about 15 of them extant. And they range from like 20-year span of time in all different types. Some of them are gospel harmonies of the type that I showed here. Others are harmonizing the five books of Moses. Two of them have no images. Some of them are almost entirely images. at some point I would love to just like have a talk where I just show images of harmonies because they're really quite extraordinary. In some of the images they're cutting up 12 or more different prints and then pasting them back together to produce something that looks like a title page, but they're doing it at the level of cutting out little clouds and like pasting them down and cutting out little columns and pasting them down, but all to make it look like it's actually a printed thing, but it's a cut up. So yeah, they're extraordinary books.
I think your talk has made me think about Don McKenzie, and I wonder, could you extrapolate how the short-circuiting of history, is that, did I get the phrase right? How that is related to something like his concept of the sociology of texts. Because in moments it sounds like something very similar, but then in others, not. So can you disambiguate those two things?
Yeah, no, that's a really great question. So Don McKenzie, there's a really interesting passage in one of his articles that I'm forgetting where he's doing a close reading. And he actually is criticizing everybody else for not close reading the material artifact, but he inadvertently close reads a text instead and didn't go back to the material artifact. And it results in this kind of confusion. And I think that that's not a McKenzie problem, right? He's brilliant. That's a print problem. And it's the fact that he's bound up in a print milieu in which he couldn't access those books. He couldn't get up a digital image of them. Right, and all he had was the textual edition in front of him. So I guess if I could port that point into something more like where we are now, it would be that's happening to us now, that we're missing what we're close reading by not actually looking at the material artifact, and that we shouldn't be, because precisely the power of this moment is the ability to have access to all different ways of being with these objects, right? I mean, it's we are in a moment where I could do anything with the harmony. I could like cut up images of them and create some crazy weird visualization, right? I mean, I could do things with them that I just couldn't do before. So I guess it's kind of like a why not? You know, let's go back to the object. We're bound up in the period that we are, but let's be aware of that and maybe tactical in our deployment of it, if that makes sense.
I mean, and I'm sorry, this is beginning of your talk, but as an art historian, I mean, these are issues we've had. Go back to the object if you can, if it's still extant, versus using slides, reproductions, etc. And I'm wondering if you've been looking at our historical discussions about those distinctions as you work on this.
I haven't, but I would love to talk to you or whatever about that, because I think that's a really interesting point. I mean, the parallel, and I'm in an English department, and the parallel would be, we use the Norton Critical Anthology, right? And the Norton Critical Anthology is going to tell us, it's going to teach students, it's going to make students read Shakespeare. It's not going to teach them a critical thinking skill related to what it means to read Shakespeare as a book or as a text that's circulated in particular ways. So there's probably a perfect parallel there with how slides and everything have been used in art history that would be very relevant.
We've had this conversation before, but I'm wondering if you can speak to it a little bit more, because I'm really interested in it. It's basically about the dynamic between something like media archaeology or more broadly media studies and textual studies and book history. And I guess my question is, like from your reading, you mentioned Ernst, for instance, and we talked about, like, you know, largely media archaeology, people don't tend to talk about text or books, or if they do, they make really quick, fast image references, or they want to talk about paper. So at least in that work, what do you think it is about the book history that makes the book not a medium, or at least not a medium that they pursue with much interest or much research?
Are you asking what makes the book not a medium to book historians?
No, sorry, to people in media archaeology, oh. It seems like there's always, like, if the gesture is to look at these kind of prehistories for digital culture to better understand material resistance, that there's just a rife amount of material already out there.
Yeah.
Maybe, is it just a disciplinary divide?
Maybe your historical one, since, as we talked about a little bit, but, you know, so much book history work comes out of kind of Renaissance literary work, and so we're looking at 16th, 17th century, and media archaeology is looking at 19th, 20th century primarily, and so there's that divide. I don't know. I mean, there's increasingly a small group like Bill Sherman, whose book I just mentioned, used books, that are looking at books as kind of used artifacts, but the pressures of English as a discipline in which most bibliographers might find themselves in America are such that you still have to talk about it as literature. So you get all these kind of metaphors of, like, you know, Shakespeare is using books as a wonderful material metaphor, but it's still about Shakespeare, right? Or whatever. It's never about the book. So, like, the direction is Shakespeare to book. It's not like book to Shakespeare. It's the other way around. Excuse me, book to Shakespeare, not Shakespeare to book. And contra that, you know, archival mechanisms have totally elided the, you know, a lot of things like the harmony. So, you know, a great example is at the British Library, they have 3 harmonies, I think. One of them is cataloged in the manuscript collection, and the others are in the print collection. And they're separate rare book rooms. Like, they're separate rooms that you have to go to. So, and in fact, the people in the rare book room didn't seem to know that the people in manuscripts had another one. So, and I talked, and there's one at the Bodleian Library at Oxford also, and where it's, I think it's cataloged as manuscript, but it's cataloged as manuscript because it has handwritten annotations in it, which are King Charles's annotations. But so it's, you know, where do you put these things? I mean, it resists the kind of categories that we have. So that's why I like media as a category, actually, because it cuts across that a lot of times.
So the question about Mackenzie made me think. It's been a long day. So Mackenzie is very interested in the transmission of text, but by that he generally means subsequent editions.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But to, I guess, reveal my book historical hobby horse as somebody who studies bookmobiles, I wonder what role the travel of the harmonies to, say, the Houghton Library, right, or to Oxford, or to the British Library, plays in how you're thinking about retransmitting them digitally?
That is an excellent question, and I would love to talk to you about bookmobiles. So an interesting little anecdote about that, how I originally had this had nothing to do with the Uzan stuff. It actually had to do with this story, which is how the Houghton got its copy of the Harmony, which is basically this guy found, he was a George Herbert scholar. George Herbert was related to the Little Gidding community. George Herbert scholar, he was, you know, he had this old catalog, and somebody had sent him a book that was wrapped in this old book, a catalog for books. He opens up the catalog and just kind of browses through, because as he tells the story, he's a bibliophile and couldn't, even if it's trash, if it's a book catalog, he has to look at it. And he finds this book that's described as a blot, used for blotting paper, but that something in it triggered his mental map. And he said, I wonder if that's a Little Gidding Harmony. So he sent for it, got it, and it turned out it was a Little Gidding Harmony. It's the one that they have at the Houghton right now. Not blotting paper. and so that came, he bought that, and he died a few years later, unfortunately, and it ended up at Harvard, and it was one of the books on display at the 1939 World's Fair. Now, this is a crazy and weird story that this book would end up in the Royal Room at the 1939 World's Fair. And I would argue is entirely bound up in this whole idea of how our histories circulate and how the history of the object, the material history of the object that accretes on the object, how we read it. Because at the 1939 World's Fair, it was probably there because it's annotated by King Charles, right? So people want to come marvel at the king's hand and just be near an object that the king touched, right? Now we marvel at it for a totally different reason, and yet it was at the first future-themed World's Fair. So there's all these kind of weird resonances, and you can't ascribe intention to any of this, right? But how the book circulates and how it circulates within particular historical periods and everything could be read in these kind of more creative ways. You could be creative with how we tell these histories in a way that I think says a lot about the book itself and our relationship to it. I hope that made sense, because that was a lot of words. But yeah, it's a really interesting story. Any other questions? Well, thanks so much for listening.